Good morning, everybody. This morning we've got Jerry doing special music for us, and then Doug will be bringing the message. Hope you enjoy today.
All right, this first song we're going to do when we all get to heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout victory while we walk the pilgrim pathway. Clouds will overspread the sky, but when traveling days are over, not a shadow or a sigh when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day. Just one glimpse of him in glory will the tolls of life repay when we all get to heaven. What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all see Jesus. We'll sing and shout the victory. Okay, now we're going to go to the book, page 543. And till the storm passes by.
You ready, sir?
Yep.
Thank you. message is going to be based on 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1. You know, initially I was going to do the first six verses of 1 Peter chapter 4. And then I went out and I bought myself a new study Bible, a Barber. And I started reading some of the notes on it. And it wouldn't all fit in one message, so I had to go down to just one verse today. I like this Bible. It really helps out. So we're going to do 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 1 and only verse 1 today.
Alright.
And that verse tells us, "For as much then as Christ hath suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves likewise with the same mind. For he that suffereth in the flesh hath ceased from sin." Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together today and worship your holy name. Lord, we ask that you just do a mighty work here in this service today, Lord. Just guide and direct my tongue that your message will come clearly through, that it'll be your message and not mine. Lord, just open the hearts of those that are watching this on Facebook today, Lord, or YouTube, or whatever medium they're using, Lord. And just let them glean from this message, Lord. Let them have a closer walk with you. Just guide and direct in all things, and let your will be done. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. The verse starts out by bringing us back to Peter's discussion about the suffering of Christ. The fact that Christ died for us, the just for the unjust. If we go back to 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 to 24, it tells us, "For even hereunto were ye called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example, that ye should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth, who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sins, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes we were healed." Christ suffered. Christ died, and he did it for us. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 kind of reiterates that point. It says, "For Christ also hath suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit." Christ died for us, but he did not die in sin. Christ is righteous. No sin was found in him. Matthew chapter 27, verses 23 and 24 tells us, "And the governor said, Why, what evil hath he done? But they cried out the more, saying, Let him be crucified. When Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent of the blood of this just person. See ye to it." Luke chapter 23, verse 4 tells us, "Then said Pilate to the chief priests and to the people, I find no fault in this man." Jesus was a righteous man. He was without sin. And the leaders, the political leaders at that time in Israel, saw that. They recognized that he was just, that he is without fault. But the religious leaders were opposed to him. So Jesus did not die in sin. He had no sin to die in. But neither did Jesus die under sin. He was not controlled by sin. The sinful world could not kill him. He died of his own accord, his own willingness. He died for us. Matthew 27 verse 50 tells us, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, he yielded up the ghost. He yielded it up. Nobody took it from him. Mark 15:37 again, with Jesus on the cross. And Jesus cried with a loud voice and gave up the ghost. Luke chapter 23 verses 44 to 48 tells us, and it was about the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. And the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was rent in the midst. And when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, he said, Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. He gave it up. He surrendered his own life. Nobody took it from him. John chapter 19 verse 30 tells us, when Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Again, Jesus surrendered it of his own free will. He gave his life for us. Nobody took it. He gave up the ghost of his own accord. He followed the will of God. Jesus is God. And being God, he followed his own will. He voluntarily suffered and died for our sins. Christ did not die in sin. He did not die under sin. But Christ did die to sin. He died in the flesh. He took our place. He paid the price for our sin. He no longer, because he died to sin, he no longer has any kind of a relationship with sin at all. His resurrection overcame the power of sin. Because of Christ, because of his suffering, because of his death and his resurrection, we too can be free from sin. We too can be dead to sin. You know, Romans 3:23 tells us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You know, every one of us has committed a sin. Every one of us has taken something that didn't belong to us. We might have only been this high when we did it, but that was still a sin. Every one of us has told a lie. Every one of us has lusted after something. We're all sinners. Romans 3:9-12 tells us, what then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have proved both Jews and Gentiles that they are all under sin. As it is written, there's none righteous, no, not one. None of us are perfect. None of us are righteous. Romans 6:23 starts out saying, for the wages of sin is death. Death in the Bible refers to a eternal separation from God. It means that if God is in heaven and heaven is perfect and righteous, we are going to be separated from there. There's only one other place. It's hell. And that's where we're bound in our sin. That's the wages. That's what we have earned with our sin. And then they got this neat little semicolon in the Bible that separates this thought. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There's a way out. There is a way to escape eternity in hell, and that way is Jesus Christ. I'm thankful for that way.
Amen.
Romans 5:6 says, "For when we were yet without sin, in due time Christ died for the ungodly." He died for me. He died for you. He gave us that opportunity to have salvation. Romans 5:8 tells us, "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." He knew we were sinners. He knew we were the unjust. And yet, he voluntarily gave up his life for us. Romans 10, verses 9 through 11 tells us that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. If we believe in the death, the crucifixion, the resurrection of Jesus Christ, we can be saved. Romans 10:13 tells us, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." It doesn't say some you might be saved. It doesn't say you're going to be saved someday. It says you're going to be saved. You're saved now if you believe. This book, 1 Peter, is written to fellow believers. It's telling them, it's reminding them, Christ suffered in the flesh. Christ was crucified and died in the flesh. Christ died in the flesh of his own will, his own voluntary act. Christ was resurrected in a glorified body. That glorified body is now totally dedicated to the will of God, because God resurrected him. You know, we who are saved are called on to be in one accord with the Lord. We are to be totally devoted to the will of God. When we are saved, we die to sin, because Jesus paid the price for our sin. He paid this price for us. That's what it means in this verse when it says, "Arm yourselves likewise with the same mind." We are to be in one mind with Jesus. Romans 12, verses 1 and 2 tells us, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And do not conform to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." We are to be dead to sin also, as Jesus is dead to sin. The verse ends, "For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin." Ceased is a poor translation here. The passive form of the Greek means to be released from, and that's a much better translation. We are released from sin. We're released from that penalty. because Jesus Christ paid for that penalty on the cross for us. And as we already discussed, he did that voluntarily. As Christians living for God, we are also released from that fleshly desire to sin. Does that make us sinless? Absolutely not. It only means that the lust of sin is gone from us. This is a new nature. We are to be devoted to Christ. 2 Corinthians 5:17 and 18 tells us, "Therefore, if any be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new." And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation. We are to practice self-denial of our fleshly desires and live a life devoted to Jesus Christ. Matthew 19:26 tells us, "But Jesus beheld them and said unto them, With men this is impossible, but God all things are possible." Amen. As Christians, we can do anything we want to do. I had an old pastor that down in Kansas when I lived down there. Pastor used to use this all the time. We can do anything we want to do as Christians. But on the day of our salvation, our want to changes. And that's what this is getting at here. We now should want to do the will of God. "For he who hath suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin" can also be viewed as the opposite of Psalms 34:21. Chapter 34, verse 21 of Psalms tells us, "Evil shall slay the wicked, and they that hate the righteous shall be desolate." Here we see that evil shall slay the wicked. Slay means to kill, to bring death to. Death in the Bible means an eternal separation from God, as we've already said, or eternal suffering in hell. The unrepentant sinner will be consumed by evil to death. The sinner will pay the price for his sin in eternity in hell. But the sinner who has come to the Lord, who believes in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, will enjoy eternity in heaven. Not for what he's done, but for what Jesus did for him. Because of Jesus, we are dead to sin. If you don't know the power of God in your life, today can be the day to come to that saving knowledge of Christ. Christ, Jesus, God, is still in the saving business. If you need counseling for this, you can contact us here at the chapel at any time. Come on Facebook, email, phone call. If you're at SAP Brothers in Cheyenne, Wyoming, stop in and say hello. We'd love to work with you. And remember, John 3:16 tells us, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." If you don't know the Lord is your Savior today, let this be the day. Reach out to us. Let us help you. Let's pray.
Doug, before you pray, we missed our prayer request this morning.
Oh, prayer requests, okay. I'm going to pray for Mike Little.
Yes.
With COVID in Alaska, the Tweedy family for physical and spiritual healing.
Isla Rowan.
Isla?
Yeah. Rowan.
Rowan and his illness.
And Torrington, yeah. We're not sure what.
Okay.
What's up? Just a second.
Well, of course, we're going to pray for drivers and their families. Yeah, for rain and moisture, for the wildfires and the firefighters, and for my grass and everything else.
Yes. Yes. So.
I've been watering my grass all the time, dragging the hose around the old-fashioned way, and it keeps getting a little bit browner and browner and browner. And the other night I walked out there.
Has it been dry over here?
Huh? Oh, it's been extremely dry.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
We're under serious fire.
I walked out there the other day to open to turn on the sprinkler, and even deaf me could hear the crunching under my feet as I walked across the grass. Isn't that a pretty sight?
Yeah, it's dry.
I work for the city water department in town, and one of our crews was out working a couple weeks ago right across the street from my house. They were digging down to the water line and correcting a valve down there, but they came back and they asked me, "Those people ever water their grass?" And I says, "No, it's rental property. They don't do anything with it." And he says, "You know, we were 4 feet down before we saw any sign of moisture at all. It's that dry."
it's scary bad.
Okay, let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you once again for this opportunity to gather in your house, Lord. We ask that you just do a mighty work with this message, Lord, to be with the drivers out there, Lord, to keep them safe on the road today. Be with their families back home. Be with these that were mentioned, Lord, with illnesses and injuries and everything, Lord. Be with the drought situation, the firefighters, Lord. Lord, it's all in your will. It's all in your capable hands. And Lord, we commend it all to you. Lord, we just ask that you do a great work here, Lord. Let the glory of it all be yours. And let others see your hand in it. In the name of Lord Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
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 You're up, Jerry.
Okay.
All right, we're going to do one more song from the hymnal, page 305. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all to him I owe.
thanks to everybody online that attended, and thank you for coming in, and see you all next week. Be sure to stop by sometime if you're in town. Thank you.